Okay. Hello, everyone. Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for coming back after the break. I hope you've all managed to grab a cup of coffee and for coming to join us. So, hi, I'm delighted to welcome you all to this special session, public engagement session this afternoon, exploring the dimensions of research into the developing human brain. For those of you that don't know me, my name is Lee Wilson, and I lead on public engagement across the MRC Centre for Neurodevelopmental Disorders and the Centre for Developmental Neurobiology at King's College London. And today's session is a recorded hybrid event. And so I would just like to extend a warm welcome to our guests joining us via Zoom. Hello. And for the benefit of our online attendees, today's public engagement session is part of a two-day research symposium presenting advances across a wide spectrum of concepts, techniques, and models, exploring our understanding of human neurodevelopment and the interface with neurodevelopmental conditions. So in this session, we hope to create a space where members of the public and researchers come together to consider some of the different aspects and perspectives involved in human development research, which is what we've been hearing about all day today. Today's session will be chaired by Professor Richard Wingate, Principal Investigator at the MRC Centre for Neurodevelopmental Disorders and Editor-in-Chief of brainfacts.org. In a second, I'll pass over to Richard to introduce our three speakers, who will each give short presentations to introduce their areas of interest. After this, we will then be inviting questions and discussion from members of the audience, online and in person. Please could those people joining us on Zoom enter their questions in the question function on Zoom. And Richard and I will do our best to help facilitate that conversation. Finally, please could we all be aware that and mindful that some topics related to human research raised today in today's discussions may be of a sensitive nature to some people. That's the housekeeping. And I would like to hand over now, if that's okay, to you, Richard, with thanks and to our wonderful panel members. So thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Lee. And so just going to expand a little bit on what Lee was saying before, that the last few years have seen an explosion in the interest in studying human donated samples in neurodevelopment, studying the development of the brain. And this work has shown that there's some features of human brain development that are unique, and that uniqueness is important not only in understanding what makes our brain special, but also really important in understanding neurodevelopmental disorders and mental health conditions, a lot of whose origins can be found in the womb. So the dimensions of this research are similar to all research that we do in the lab. It involves integrity, it involves ethics, it involves explaining the need to do this research, but there's also another important element with using human samples, and that's that element of consent. So consent from the donors, but also a sort of broader consent from the general public for the kind of research that we do. And that's the kind of dimensions that we're going to be exploring today with our three speakers. Our speakers are Dr. Tom Arici, Dr. Nita Solanki, and Dr. Hélène Derflinger. And I'm going to introduce them. I'm going to actually introduce you one by one as you come up and speak. So we won't have questions after each of their short presentations. What we'll do is we'll have these presentations, then we'll have a small panel discussion, then open up the questions to you, and also, as Lee said, to people from outside this room who are watching on Zoom. So we're going to start with Tom. So Dr. Tom Arici is a Medical Research Council clinical scientist and a reader in perinatal imaging at the Centre for the Developing Brain at King's College London at St. Thomas's Hospital. So he's also an honorary consultant in paediatric neurodisability at the Evelina London Children's Hospital. So, Tom, I'm going to hand over to you.
Thanks, Richard. That was quite a mouthful, wasn't it? Introducing me. Let me just get my presentation up. Fab. Okay, so great. So what I thought I'd do is just briefly give a chat just about the kind of work that I do, but then also about some of the issues that I found over the years as a clinical researcher and as a clinician from talking to families and some of the kind of common questions that they've got and some of the concerns that they've had. And then hopefully that can try and put things a little bit in context and help with the kind of discussion that that will then follow between us all. So as Rich said, I work for King's College London as a reader in perinatal imaging. And so my research itself really focuses on using non-invasive imaging methods, actually particularly MRI, to study how the human brain develops both inside the womb, so in the fetus, and also during early infancy. And really that work is motivated by my work as a consultant in pediatric neurodisability. And so I qualified as a medical doctor back in 2001. And I realized as I was working as a consultant, or as a doctor initially in pediatric neurology and pediatric neurodisability, there was so much that we didn't really know about why children were having these difficulties, and there were limits on what we could do for these children. And so really what I wanted to do is then to try and further my knowledge and to try and further hopefully everyone's knowledge so that we could really move things forward and change these children's lives. So I spend most of my days apart from doing my research, counselling families where their baby may have unfortunately got some altered brain development or some injury to their brain, and then also managing the care of these children who unfortunately have got some neurological difficulties from difficulties with their brain. And so on the right is just a picture of one of the families I care for. The family kindly consented for me to use the picture here, who's a wonderful little three-year-old boy who unfortunately suffered a lack of oxygen at birth and went on to have cerebral palsy and epilepsy. Obviously he has challenges, but he has a wonderful, wonderful family and a wonderful life, and there are things that he enjoys and things that he can show that he loves his parents and things that he can really get satisfaction from. And I really want to emphasize that that's something that's really important and passionate to me, and it's important to think about when we're doing our research as well about how we can help these families. So I thought what I'd do is start with an example of the kind of work that I do in my clinical practice and think about how that then keys into the kind of research that we're all doing in this room. And so a common example might be I might get asked to go to the fetal medicine unit in the hospital, and they've been told from the ultrasound that's been done there's an abnormality with the cerebellum, and I've been asked to go and see the family and discuss with them about that abnormality with the cerebellum. And the common kind of questions and the discussion I've had over the years with this family, and now I'm kind of, in a way, I'm almost prepared because I know that there are quite common themes across those things, and that's why I put these in here, because I think they're quite useful for us to think about in terms of the discussion that we're going to have. So the parents, obviously, they want to know, what does it mean? Is their baby in danger? Are they going to die? What does it mean as the pregnancy continues? What can be done about it? Is there a treatment? Why has it happened? Is it something that they did, which is the commonest question I get? Was it because I went to France 12 weeks into pregnancy and ate some cheese? You know, I get these kind of questions all the time. Is it because we've got a cat? You have these questions, and the parents, these are immediately the thoughts are running through their head. And of course, when will we know what it means for the future? Okay, and the commonest question then follows is, what's going to be the quality of life for my child as well in the future? And then, of course, we might have a discussion about whether or not it's appropriate for them to continue with the pregnancy, which, of course, is another big discussion to have. And so decision making in these situations is, of course, incredibly personal. But what families want in general is, of course, more information. And so, of course, that's where research comes into this, is that hopefully with the kind of research that we're doing, we can start to unpick each one of these different things, the what and the why and the when of what's happening inside the brain during the pregnancy and what it means for the future. And so, although, as Richard said, many neuroscience questions, of course, can be answered through animal studies, what we've discovered is there are also many that can only be answered really by looking at human tissue and subjects. And I think some of the really good examples I've seen recently are things like Down syndrome, for example. So Down syndrome, there are animal models of Down syndrome, but they really can't recapitulate the full clinical picture of Down syndrome. We know and have known for many years, of course, that Down syndrome is results of from trisomy 21. But actually, you see some children who have all, you know, they've all got trisomy 21, but you see some kids who have got very profound learning disabilities and various different systemic difficulties. And you've got others who are actually very high functioning, they have very few difficulties, for example, with their heart or other systems and things like that, and perhaps their learning difficulties aren't so profound. And so the animal models can't necessarily give us that information to understand why there's this spectrum of differences in kids. Similarly with autism and mental health conditions. So the second part, of course, to understanding then why difficulties happen and how we might be able to treat them is really to understand how something develops normally. And that means we can gain that information to be able to start to piece together what happens, unfortunately, when things are developing slightly differently. So in terms of patient understanding of research, the common kind of conception is that many families are willing to take part in research, especially if they think they're going to benefit in some way, okay, if they receive an incentive. If we give them some extra information or access to an additional treatment or something like that. I have to say my experience from that is not nearly so cynical. So my experience is that families are, many of them are willing to take part in research. Okay, the majority of them are willing to take part in research if they know it's going to help others. And of course, if there's some degree of risk-benefit ratio in their mind, if they have enough information and they feel the risks to them, to society, to their unborn child are low. And so I think I'm trying to give, I suppose, a positive message here, and I think hopefully that this is a similar kind of message that we'll discuss through things. I think the important thing is that families are willing to take part in research if they get that right kind of information to be able to make that kind of informed choice. These are some of the key questions and issues that I've come across in my experience with talking to families in my clinical practice and seeing if they'll consent for research. So the first one, if it's a fetus, of course, is make a decision as a parent for another person. And that keys into the second one, is when does life begin, which is, this is a ginormous question, of course. So when is something conscious? When does it start to feel pain? When can it remember what's being done to it? And this is a giant philosophical question, which of course is a big can of worms that we could probably spend 6 hours talking about. But this is, of course, something that's it's important to families to think about and for us to think about as researchers. I took part in a Royal College of Obstetrics guidance document we convened at the end of last year to discuss this, and the kind of final point we reached was that we would say the evidence suggests that complex perception processing behavior occurs predominantly in the cortex and involves coordinated activity across multiple brain regions, and that's not really in place until around 24 weeks gestation. And I think that's something that can obviously open a much wider discussion, but that's, I suppose, a starter for 10, should we say, on that discussion. The second question that parents often have is what are the long-term effects of any research? So if it's on a child, not necessarily, on a fetus and then they go on to be born, or a child and they go on to grow on through childhood, what would be the long-term effect of it? And I think the last one, which is again a wider discussion, is suspicion about the use of their data. So how will it be kept private? This discomfort about knowing that other people are going to be accessing the data or accessing these samples of their child, and without their knowledge and without knowing what's going to happen to that tissue. So what happens next is really the question that parents have. And I suppose from our perspective, one question to ask is, do parents and families really want to know? Do they have a right to know what happens to the tissue afterwards? If we anonymize it completely, and if this is a family who unfortunately have terminated a pregnancy, is it really appropriate for them to be contacted and told what's happened to the tissue? Do they want to be contacted afterwards? Do they want to be reminded what perhaps is one of the most painful moments in their lives? And so that's something to consider. If so, how do we communicate this information in a timely and sensitive and accessible way to patients and families? And of course, how do we involve all the key stakeholders? So not just the patients and families, but also the other clinicians, other researchers, members of the public more widely, charities, policymakers, and so on in this communication and dissemination. And lastly, just to think about how it's shaping our own research. So it's important for us to understand the barriers to participation, the lines that, for instance, shouldn't be crossed, and those that sort of exist, I suppose, through misconceptions and assumptions, which is perhaps something we'll discuss today. And remember that these misconceptions and these assumptions actually exist on our side as well. So it's not just in the public, and it's not just in the people taking part in the research. It's also amongst all of us in this room. We've got our own assumptions and preconceptions about what we think about what the public will want to know and what they should be able to know. It's important we make the research that we do socially and culturally accessible and meaningful to the families, which is something that I get fed back, is that it doesn't mean too much to them, or they don't understand it. And with patients and families, of course, what do they really want to know? But I thought I'd close with just something which actually is interesting. I was discussing it with one of the other panelists earlier, and is really when I do speak to families, and particularly when I attend public engagement events, what comes across to me is a very consistent thing, is it's very inspirational talking to them, and very motivational actually from talking to families and to patients, and knowing that actually they really respect the work that's being done, and they really do support the research that's being done. And I think that's an important message to put across, because sometimes I think as researchers, and also what we get from the press, is it almost feels like that we shouldn't feel that way. And I think actually it's very motivating to speak to people who are who are the ones who impacted the most. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Tom. So as I said, we'll go through the talks first, and then we'll have a panel discussion, then open up for questions. So our next speaker is Dr. Nita Solanki. She is the resource manager for the Human Developmental Biology Resource, and she's also a research fellow at the Institute of Child Health here in London. So, Nita.
Great, thank you. So, as Richard said, I manage a human embryonic and fetal tissue bank. It's called the Human Developmental Biology Resource, we call it HDBR. So, it's quite big. We probably get about 450 embryos and fetuses a year, and we supply them to people worldwide. So I'm here to talk about my experience with that. So I've been managing that, but I've also worked on a number of different biobanks. My background's all pregnancy and pregnancy complications. And one part of my job that I really like, which I insisted on when I took this job, was that I'm still able to go and talk to patients for when I recruit them. And as I was talking with Tom earlier, it really is motivational. They think what we do is amazing, and it's good to give them feedback and stuff. So what I'm going to do first of all is talk a little bit about the HDBR, so you can see what sort of samples and stuff we actually get. I'll go through the consent process for it, and then we've ran a feedback survey which we give to all the women who we approach, so women who consent to giving their samples and also ones who decline, so we can get an idea about the sort of comments and the feelings they have about the research we do. So the HDBR, we collect fetal and embryonic samples. These are from women who are having terminations for like normal healthy pregnancies, as well as ones with fetal abnormalities. And we collect up to 22 weeks post-conception. So that's 22 weeks gestation, which is the limit here in the UK. It's a large study. We've got a couple of centres, one here at UCL, which I manage, and one in Newcastle. And we collect samples from quite a few different hospitals. Some are NHS ones and some are private abortion care clinics. So we all here know from all the talks you've already listened to about why it's really important to have these sort of why we need human tissue. Having a centralized fetal tissue resource like the HDBR is really, really useful. It overcomes lots of ethical and governance issues that we have when collecting the tissue. For the researchers, these samples are very, very rare. So if a researcher was going to start their own collection, it'll take them quite some time to get a significant number. And because we support lots of different projects, each sample we get can be used by multiple projects. So you get more use, more value from each sample. It also means that there's a buffer when in your sample supply. So we've got about 6-7 different clinics we collect at. If one clinic stops collecting for whatever reason, there'll be other ones that can make up the samples. Does that make sense? For the HDBR, it's an ongoing collection, so we get fresh samples. There's also a large archive of fixed and frozen samples, which we're continually replenishing. And there's also like an in-house gene expression service. So if people don't want the tissue or they can't do the research themselves for whatever reason, then we can do the research for them and give them the data. So that's sort of things we do. This is just showing how many samples we collect a year. It's about 450. So in the last year, we collected like 457 embryos, but from there we allocated 1,500 aliquots, and we supported 128 different projects. So having a resource just means you get so much more use out of any one sample. And this is what we've collected since the beginning of time, is like 8,000 embryos. So as well as the normal pregnancies, we collect samples from fetal abnormalities. The vast majority of fetal abnormalities we see are due to chromosomal aneuploidies, the main one being Down syndrome, but you get other ones as well. I won't go into that. So that's just about how many samples we collect. So for the samples that are that have had the pregnancy termination because of a fetal abnormality, those you generally only get in the second trimester, because in the first trimester, women wouldn't know that they have an abnormality, and then they need time to make a decision and then contact the clinic. So they tend to all be first trimester. However, all the samples we get in the HDBR are karyotyped, so the normal ones and the ones that are abnormal, just to check what the abnormality is. And we've found that we have quite a lot of samples, first trimester samples, that do have an abnormality. And we have archived tissue from there for researchers who would want it. The only thing about these ones are, when you karyotype it, it takes us a month or two, because you get a batch and send them off. So that wouldn't be available for as fresh tissue, because you wouldn't know that is abnormal. Kind of thing. Cool. So all of these samples, all of the material the HDBR have, is donated voluntarily with informed consent by women who are undergoing an abortion. And although it's a really emotive time for them, and they don't actually have that long to decide whether they want to take part or not, because you know they've got a procedure to do, 60% of the women that we approach who are offered the option to donate to the HDBR actually say yes to it. So I'll just quickly go over the consent process. For the HDBR, it's really quite simple. So when we go to the clinics, the person who consents is completely separate from the clinical care team. So there's no way that the potential donor will feel that there's any influence over their care. Also, we would never talk about the HDBR or any option about research until the lady's already made the decision to have the abortion. So we're not influencing that at all. So once we know someone's decided to have the termination, to be eligible, they need to be over 16. They need to be able to understand the patient information sheet and consent form. And if we know they've got a bloodborne infection, then we don't take them. But there's no screening of them, so they are potentially infectious. So once we've identified suitable women, we provide them information about the resource, so verbally, and there's an information sheet, and then we give them time to consider. If they do want to take part, there's a consent form for them to sign, and then they're given the option to do additional things. So we've got a health questionnaire and their saliva samples they can collect. Everything's completely anonymous with these samples. Even the consent forms, we don't keep a copy of that with the resources kept in the clinic. So there's no way whatsoever that we can be that the sample can be linked back to the donor. And that's really, really important for a lot of the donors. That's one of the first questions that they ask about. So it's completely anonymous. The downside of that is, once the sample's left the clinic, there's no way for them to withdraw. And also, if there is anything medically relevant, any medically relevant results, there's no way of us to identify the patient and feed back to them. I've worked on other biobanks. one biobank was, it was a pregnancy related one, so it was lots of different pregnancy complications, and we collected samples from the mum, the dad and the baby as well. And with that, it was completely separate, it was completely important that we kept the information about the donors, because at any point in the future, any of the parents or even the baby when it grows up might decide that they don't want to take part. So we need to be able to identify who they were so that we can withdraw their samples. So once we've collected the samples, they're packaged and sent to the lab. At that point, they're completely anonymized. In the lab, they're staged to see how old they are, they're processed and they're sent on to researchers. And I think about half of the samples we collect are sent out as fresh samples, so usually the same day. So a little bit about the patient research experience survey that we've done. So this was to evaluate the service we provided from the woman's perspective. So we did two versions of the survey. One was for the women who decided to donate to the HWBR, and the other was for women who said, who declined. They were basically identical, apart from there was one question about asking their reasons for why they donated or decide or decline, and there was one which was a satisfaction rating for the women who donated. The surveys are completely anonymous. We've conducted them against across three of our sites, and it's been going on since about 2020. So the data I'm going to show you is of here we handed the survey out to 432 women. 35% of them were women who declined, the rest were the ones who donated to the HWBR, and the response rate was about 60%, so about 6% of the women gave the survey back. This response rate was higher for the ones who donated, which you'd kind of expect, there was 68% compared to the women who declined. So the survey looked like this, it was quite user-friendly. Looked at how they felt about their privacy and confidentiality, staff professionalism and approachability, the quality of the information we gave them, and their reasons for consenting and declining. They were given, it's called a Linkart scale, where you could rate it from one, which is strongly disagree, to five, which is strongly agree. So this slide just shows the average scores for both the surveys. So the orange bars show the data from the women who declined, and the blue ones are from the women who consented. So overall, the women rated all elements of their experience very highly, irregardless of whether they decided to, whether they chose to donate or not. And the bottom bar, the blue bar at the bottom, it shows the average for the donors. So that one was for the women who decided to donate, and they were asked if they'd had a good experience in taking part in the research study, and the average score for that was 4.8 out of 5. So this slide shows some of the reasons why the women decided to donate to the HWBR, and the majority of them, 92 out of the 189, donated because they wanted to help others, so just completely altruistic. Other reasons were that they were interested in the research itself, and also because it didn't affect their care in any way. Nobody said that they felt pressurized by either family, friends or staff, so that was good. The reasons why the women declined to donate was a bit more varied. The most common one was that they were uncomfortable with some aspects of the research, but some of them were too upset or they saw no benefit in taking part. In all of the surveys, there was a bit of free text where they could elaborate on how they were feeling. And these are just a small section. So the comments were extremely positive. Many mentioned giving value to the remains. the research helping others and how comfortable the research had made them feel. For the women who declined donation, they also responded positively and showed appreciation for having had the option to participate. So in general, the data from the survey shows that fetal tissue donation is highly acceptable to women, and the option to donate is valued by the woman, regardless of their decision to donate. That's all I've got. I'll just leave a few of the comments that were fed back.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Nita. That's really, really fascinating and useful for us all, I think. So our final speaker before we have a discussion is Dr. Hélène Derflinger. And Hélène is the public engagement manager and a research associate at the Gurdon Institute at Cambridge. And she's also a member and a public engagement specialist for the Human Developmental Biology Initiative. So, Hélène, thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Richard. Yes, so I do work at the Gurdon Institute, where we study developmental biology using a lot of different models, so not only human models. But there are three labs at the Gurdon Institute, which are part of the Human Development Biology Initiative, HDBI. And this initiative and all the public engagement part of it is led by Naomi Clement-Broad, and we do a lot of projects together. So there are, I don't know how familiar you are with public engagement, but I see a few faces from the HDBI, so at least I know that those are very familiar with it. There are many ways to define public engagement. For me, it's really about generating projects that connect people, generate bridges and between science and society, and help everyone involved to gain new skills and perspective. So whenever we do a new project or we run an event, we want to make sure that there's a real dialogue between the scientists and the public. We don't just want a scientist speaking in front of an audience and that's it. We also want both parties to get something out of it, being either skills or new information that they can get out of the discussion, for example. So why does public engagement matter? First of all, institutions need to be open and transparent to be accountable for what they're doing. There's also values and purpose. Institutions should commit to wider social benefit and again to dialogue. That's so important. There's also this mention of trust, and that is so important, especially in your field when you use human tissues. And I think that institutions need to be part of the debate on the social and ethical implication of research. And finally, it's also a way to be very responsive and to make sure that public engagement helps to rebalance the power between the institution and the citizen. We try to be there to make sure that this dialogue is taking place. So why does public engagement matter as a researcher? I think it does. I'm also a researcher part of my time, and I think it does really help improving my research. It can help when you write grant application. It does really bring some outside of the box thinking sometimes when you've got a discussion about something and you may have a comment or a feedback on what you're doing, which you haven't thought about it before. It can also reconnect with motivation, and I'm sure that like me, sometimes your research is going too slow, you feel stuck somewhere. And when you discuss with someone who tell you that what you're doing is really great and really amazing, I mean, all of a sudden you feel a bit like pump up to carry on. And as I've mentioned before, it's a good way to develop new skills, being communication or learning how to edit a video, for example, for a project. And of course, you've got usually public engagement team who are here to give you training and support. And as I've mentioned before, it's also about responsibility to society, to make sure that the society and the public access to the benefit of scientific advances, to make sure that the future outcome being positive or negative are discussed with the public and keeping the public informed and involved in what we're doing. So that means that there's lots of challenges. And when we started the HDBI consortium, a survey has been made among all the researchers, and 40% said that they were not comfortable at all to speak about their research on human tissue when it comes to speak about ethics or social implication. So yeah, how do you speak about fundamental research? How to speak about the use of human cells in research? How to reach people who may not be interested in science when science is so important nowadays in our life? How to stimulate curiosity, engagement, and trust in research? How to embrace difficult conversation about research? And also very importantly, how to generate collaborative work with scientists and the public? So I won't answer all these questions now because that will take me probably more than an hour, but I will just showcase three different case studies for you to see how we approach public engagement. And what we're trying to do at the Garden Institute is to try to have a portfolio of very different projects to make sure that all the scientists can find something they can participate in. Sometimes it's a very small participation, sometimes something much more exhaustive, but we try to make sure that there's a lot of things available. The first one is called Tattoo My Science, and this is a kind of a light public engagement project that we did, where we ask all the lab in the Garden Institute to provide with one picture that would reflect their science. We transform that as a temporary tattoo, and we go to festival with it, with some researchers, and the public would choose a design, sometimes not knowing what it is about. And when they got the design applied on their arms, the researchers can tell them about what it means. And I've just highlighted this very beautiful, I think, design of a brain with a cerebellum being highlighted in the dark blue that Sumo Bain's lab did. And we also ask people, the scientists in the lab, to provide a small text that will be printed at the back of the cards on this slide. And that is also something that we give to the public. So when they've got the tattoo and some information and a little card, they can then pass on information to their friend and family. So this is a kind of a light touch sort of public engagement, but it's very popular. And for our researchers, it's also kind of a nice short way to start being engaging the public. The second example I've put there is called Experiment in Art and Science. And we did that a few years back, where we invited three artists together with Skeeter's Yard Art Gallery in Cambridge. And they spend some time in a lab they choose. They also collaborate. And I just wanted to showcase one of this work done by David Blandy. I think he had an exhibition recently at the Wellcome Gallery. And David worked with the Rixi lab on human cells grow in petri dishes that are specialized into neuron cells. And he did observe the scientist visualization of his human neuron grow from stem cells. And he used this research as a way to think about consciousness, identity, and technology. Initially, it was a VR experience, so people would have a VR and would walk around this mesh of neurons that are images that the scientists provided on 3D. So you are really immersed in kind of this mesh of neurons. And there's a poetic voiceover that David Blandy did. There's also a video, and I'll just show you 1 minute of this video now. Of course, maybe it's not the right setting. You'd be rather more immersed in the video if it would be in a black setting with some proper headphones. But I thought that I would still show it to you. Press something, yeah.
Suppose there is a brain floating in a chemically rich fluid that molecule for molecule is just like your own. Since this brain is a duplicate of what is in your head, would it think the same thoughts? Gazing down at the grid of grey matter, watching the thoughts flash through encoded fluorescence, flowing through the network, the present is lost in a haze of memories and speculation. How can you look into the thinking machine without thinking about thinking? These brain cells sparking into communication. But without a body, are these cells even working in the same way as identical cells would do, entwined in a head, bombarded by signals from sense receptors, creating a reality?
So this is just a short extract, and this time of work with the scientists and the artists was really viable to then start discussion with the public about this very fundamental question about growing neuron in a petri dish. The final example I'd like to show you is an HDBI project, and I know that some of you participate in this project. It's called Made the Same Way. It's a podcast series of 8 episodes. And in this project, we invited young artists to embrace challenging discussion about researching human biology with some scientists. And at the end of each episode, the artists did reflect on that discussion by doing a short song. Again, I won't show you full episode, they are 40 minutes, but you're more than welcome to look at, to listen to them using the QR code on finding them on your phone. I'll just show you a short clip that we did, because of course, when you do a podcast, it's one thing, but then you want to advertise for it. So we've done some clips to use on social media, and you can just have a flavor of what it is.
Do you think that science can ever answer the question of what makes us human?
I'd love to say that it can, because I love science, yeah. But I suspect we're pushing the limit here. No, we can't.
Yeah.
Tell me what it means to be human, think of who we are.
In the last 10, 11, 12 years, we've been able to grow human cells in the dish more easily. It's a really exciting time. Nature is totally amazing.
Yes, it really is.
So these were just short example I wanted to show you to show you that there's many ways you can try to engage the public with your research, and you can find many more examples on the Gurdon's website or on the HDBI website. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Elaine. So what I'm going to do now is ask our 3 speakers to come up and join me in these chairs, discussion panel style. And we'll just have a short discussion, then open it up to the general audience. So thank you very much for all your talks as well. They're fantastic. So come up. And so I thought that was absolutely fascinating, seeing the whole range of what we do with human samples, and how we deal with those issues of consent and public engagement. And Tom, I'm going to go to you first, but maybe we can. Everyone can chip in. I mean, one of the things you mentioned, which I think was interesting, was the misconceptions that exist around research when you talk we have those difficult conversations with potential donors and families. So what kind of misconceptions do they have about the work that we do?
So yes, that's obviously a very, very important question, Richard. And I suppose to a certain extent, some of it has happened because of over the last, 30 years, we had things like I won't name some of the children's hospitals, but children's hospitals where there were samples that were being kept without consent. And I think people were extremely worried and understandably upset that those samples had been kept there without their knowledge, and that research was going on there without their knowledge. And I think that's one of the biggest misconceptions, is that people are taking pieces of tissue and people are doing research on human tissue without people knowing about it. And that the research that they're doing is producing some sort of Frankenstein lives or things that are extremely worrying. Things are happening behind closed doors where we are doing things with, I'm trying to think of the right way to put it, I suppose things that they would consider to be either extremely abhorrent in terms of both religious reasons, but also socially. And that we're doing something that potentially is cruel as well to samples, which I think is the other thing that people are worried about.
So I guess the follow-up to that is whether you think there's any, and maybe this is for everyone, if there's misinformation out there in, for example, the media, press, that feeds that misconception that we are in some way Frankenstein scientists doing things which are bizarre or unacceptable with the samples that they donate?
It's a tricky one, isn't it? Because I suppose the short answer is that bad news is what sells half the time, I suppose, and sensationalism is what sells. I suppose it'd be interesting to get Helene's perspective on this as well, but I think that often what will happen with the wider press is that they obviously will pick up on stories where things are very concerning. And of course, the other things where important discoveries are being made are put out in the press. Perhaps they don't capture the public's imagination quite as much.
Well, I agree with you, Tom, and I guess it's very much newsworthy when there's something a bit like frightening, or that people, I mean, you're feeding fantasy or whatsoever, and it's far less newsworthy when you've got a story saying, we think that we may have developed this type of new discovery, or being very precocious as usually scientists are. So yes, you're right, it's it can be a problem.
I suppose I might add also that the positive stories that we have, they're often incremental, which I mean in the nicest possible way, but I mean for us, you know, we feel that they're big changes, but I suppose from a society level it's incremental, isn't it? And so they don't necessarily, they might not see a good news story as being something very significant, but it's only when you take a step back and see what's happened and what's changed in 20 years. But when the stories are sort of trickling in, then I suppose maybe they think, well, it's another false alarm, or it's a small step in a change, and they don't think it's making a significant difference to their lives.
So in a way, I was very encouraged by your survey, Nita, from potential donors who are satisfied with the way in which the material is being handled and consent, and there's no pressure involved. Interested in that idea of anonymity, and I guess whether, even though that's part of the consent process, whether there's ever any request to know exactly what's happened to specific samples, whether anyone ever comes back to you and say, well, what I made this donation, and what's happened subsequently to the samples that I let you have?
Yeah, I think it's really important to tell them right at the beginning, like any potential donors, what would happen with the results, and if there's any feedback. With this project, the HDBR, there is no, they know it's completely anonymized, and it's completely anonymized as soon, you know, from the end of the day. I've worked on other projects where I've had husbands ring me in the middle of the night going, was the baby mine? And I was like, I can't, you know, I don't know that, I can't do that. And, you know, I had to block his number after a while, but yeah, it's really, really important that people know right from the beginning. But also with feeding back results, you have to make sure that it's fed back in a way that's understandable for them. And if they need any counseling, that there is, that is there.
So I mean, it echoes what you've just said before, Elaine and Tom, about information being clear and the benefits being clear as well. But the information from the start in terms of donation is absolutely vital.
Yeah, I think it's really, really important to be clear and to tell patients exactly what they should expect and what they can get back and what they can't. And they appreciate that. They're, you know, lots of time people do want results, but if you tell them, no, there's no way of you getting results, the reason for that was because we have to protect your anonymity, then most people accept that. And it just being frank and being transparent, I think it's really important to be transparent.
Okay, so some of that information giving, particularly on the benefits, rests with us as scientists. And as you see, I'm directing questions to each person in turn. So Elaine, I was really interested in the fact that 40% of researchers are uncomfortable with the fact that they might have to talk about the fact they use human samples in their research. And is there, I mean, maybe it's obvious, but are there specific things about working with the HDMI that come out of these discussions that you can identify that would help researchers talk to the public?
So yeah, so I'm not the lead on the public engagement HDBI, Naomi Clements Brody is, but I've been, of course, attending all the session, and they've got a series of conference twice a year, if I remember well. And they've got training for public engagement. And I really think that now they're getting, I mean, maybe those who were a bit less comfortable about speaking about their research using fetal tissues, for example, are gaining confidence into speaking about it, because they've learned about what type of, not using jargon, and what is the best way to speak about it.
So I'm hoping that actually some of what we've heard today will help our members of the audience, who are a lot of us scientists here who deal with these issues in discussing this with the public. One other thing I was going to ask you actually was in terms of shaping those questions, particularly around human research. Whether you've seen examples of where the public have really managed to help form those questions. Are the things that they're interested in and the issues they're interested in really feeding back to the kind of research questions that we can ask? It's a sort of golden.
Yeah, of course, that the golden aim of public engagement is to come up with a question from the public that will completely change your research. It didn't happen to me. I'm a drosophilist working on cell polarity, so it's even tougher. However, actually, the example of David Blandy, the artist to work with this, we did this collaboration with Rick Leslie's lab. It was interesting because the question he raises in his video was actually came just, I think, the week after in the Nature paper at the end of the discussion from a researcher. So really questions are coming up, and he was really actually ahead of time in terms of trying to think about the dimension of having this neural functional neural cells in a petri dish.
Thanks. So I'm going to open this up to the audience, and also I know that Lee may or may not have questions from our public who are watching. So. No, okay, well, that's great. I think that, so let's ask the audience if there's, are there any questions for our panelists? Yes.
Hiya. A question that often comes up to me in my capacity as a researcher is really about this withdrawal of consent. So it's very easy to think as a researcher, explain to people consent, explain to what it means, but quite often, from say health professionals, they say, well, you have to have the right, every participant has to have the right to withdraw, which again at one ethical level seems perfectly fine, but I'm not really sure what that actually means. For instance, if someone has donated information to and material to a study, and then it's one piece of data in a thousand, the idea of withdrawal doesn't really work in that sort of context, and actually would almost be damaging to the integrity of the study with everybody else, because if people selectively donate their data and withdraw it, then you're going to have, I mean, everything is going to be affected. So where do people really think that lies? Is this just a false worry that we generate ourselves, or is this really a concern to people who are donating tissue and data?
I suppose just from my perspective, speaking directly to patients, I mean, it is quite rare that people want to withdraw as the first thing to say.
Well, exactly.
The second thing is that actually you just really have to make it very clear from the outset that it's not going to be possible in some cases. So it's very clearly written on the information sheet, and often ethics committees will make it clear that you actually have to have a tick box on the consent form as well, that they understand that the samples will be completely anonymized, which means that it will not be possible to identify the sample later on, which means that it can't be withdrawn at a later stage. So I think it's just really, really important that discussion is had at the time. Obviously, when you're doing human research with patients, that's a different kettle of fish altogether, and in which case then actually withdrawing them is, have to be honest, a relatively straightforward process.
Yeah, I've only had people withdraw when it was an ongoing project, when the patients have to come in quite, you know, regularly to do them. Like the project I said where the samples weren't anonymized, that was a collection of something like 5,000 samples, and we started collecting them 2010, and no one's called me up to withdraw, but we were completely transparent that they're able to withdraw, but if any samples have gone out to any researchers, then there's no ability for them to withdraw, but if it's in my freezer, then I can withdraw them. But yeah, we have to have that written down in the guidelines right from the beginning.
Yeah, thanks. Yeah, the discussion often is not with patients, it's with ethical boards and other people who are sort of, if you like, overthinking the problem.
You hear me? Yeah. So data has become a big issue in the last couple of years. I would say, I mean, it's, for us as scientists, it's always been the big thing, but for the public, data is becoming a word that they talk about a lot more. And my feeling is that trust is sort of dissipating because of the involvement of corporations. And so I get a lot of people talking to me about this idea about data being made available and classed as anonymous, but the possibility of slippage, like you're saying, do you sense that there is a change in the trust with the public in terms of clinical data in that regard?
Yeah, that one's a very easy answer, Sam. The answer is yes. So that's definitely a discussion that I have with every family that we consent. And there are some who are definitely just from the outset, that's the first thing that they'll mention, and that they're not willing to move forward with that. I think that's a societal question. It's not really just about research, is it? I mean, we all know when we buy a new mobile phone, the first thing that you have to do is make a selection about whether or not you're going to give Google or Apple all your data. I personally feel I've got nothing to hide, nothing very interesting in there either. So I always just tick, I consent, but I can see that that's obviously, it's your personal information, which is why people feel very strongly about it. And I think, again, that comes down to just information, doesn't it, about how we get across what's going to be done with the data. We make it very clear with them, and that it's on our side that we have to make sure there's very robust governance things in place, so that we can feel confident ourselves that we know what's going to happen with
yeah,
the data.
There's a lot of conflict with that in a weird way, as in a lot of funders and the ethos of your project might be that it may be to get more people to collaborate and to have have all the data out there. Mm. Because with ours, sequence any of the data, it's there and it's publicly available, and any slides or anything anyone generates, they're put back onto the database for everyone to see, because it's meant to be a collaboration and we're meant to get the most we can out of the samples. So the most common question I have is, what will happen to the DNA? Will people be able to sequence their DNA and then identify them via that?
Right. I could just follow up very quickly with another question, which is about a different issue, which is this 40% of scientists feeling uncomfortable. How does that relate to, let's say, if you're talking about Drosophila work, which is to the members of the public might not be obvious why that's being funded? Is there a similar level of you know, lack of confidence about presenting that to the public?
Well, a story that I often tell is that if I would go to a party and I knew no one, and someone asked me what I'm doing, and I say, well, I'm a scientist, the person say, oh, well, I'm living in Cambridge, so it's not that exceptional. And then they would ask me, so what type of science are you doing? I say, oh, I'm a biologist. They say, oh, cool, because all of a sudden people may understand better. And then they say, so what type of biology? They say, well, I've got a PhD in genetics, I'm a geneticist. So they say, oh, wow, that's super cool. And then if they ask even more, I say, well, actually, I'm a drosophilist. I do try to understand cell priority dissecting fruit fly ovaries. All of a sudden, the interest is like, why? What is that? Why do we spend that much money on this type of research? And that's when public engagement, kicking. And it's important to tell people why we use model, the fact that Drosophila shares 70% of gene that cause disease in human, et cetera, et cetera. So, it's not as tricky, probably, as not as sensitive as using human cells or human tissues coming from fetus, etc. But still, you have to fight your corner to showcase that, yes, this type of research has a place in the landscape.
In a sense, there's an advantage when you're talking about human research, because you can immediately sell it, right?
Absolutely. There's a mimi factor where all of a sudden you relate to this type of research.
Thank you.
Yeah, so this is really interesting. So next week we're gonna have a movie shot in the lab and about us, and we're gonna have to tell what we do. And so we did this little discussion with them, and we said we work with organoids and and then fetal tissue. And when I said fetal tissue, the guy was like, well, yeah, maybe we don't talk about that one, because, you know, it might be bad for our donators. And so at that point, I was like, yeah, sure, I get it. But then, you know, you guys get me thinking, of course, if we always do that, then nothing ever changes. So what do you think I should do? think I should talk about it, or?
Who is the movie for?
It's to to talk about the science we do in the lab and to promote an award or something like that. But yeah, I mean, it feels like there's a way to talk about it in a way that doesn't frighten everyone and makes it cool, but yeah, it just kept me thinking.
So I guess I would say it's your choice, but maybe you can get support from your public engagement team or communication team. But I feel that being transparent nowadays is really, really a big thing. I mean, research institute, you can't get in. I mean, look at the creek. I mean, there's so many steps you have to go. And being able to open the door of a research place by doing a movie, I think is amazing. So maybe you'll have to think about how you present this type of research. But I would say that it is important.
But did you ever get did it ever backfire? Like, did you ever get cases where people talked about working with fetal tissue and that actually backfired?
So far, no. Maybe, I don't know if some people working on VHDVI or others have the experience, but
research, it always does, right? Mm.
But you remember, animal research had very bad press until a lot of universities and institutes decided to sign the Concordia for Transparency. And all of a sudden, there were all no more people demonstrating in front of institutes or universities.
I was just going to add, I think that we're never going to really move forward past the status quo if we keep making the assumption that people will be put off or be upset about us doing fetal tissue research. I think we all make that assumption, which means then people who are then talking about it may avoid talking about it. And as scientists, we shy away from then engagement about it, which then just makes the situation worse, really, doesn't it? And it'll just keep going if we stay in that same position, I think. So that's why I mentioned at the end of my talk that maybe we need to move past some of the assumptions and misconceptions that we've got as well as a community.
Yeah, I mean, I feel more weird talking about all the animal work I did rather than all the fetal work I do. But I mean, with this one, it's easy because I can say with abortions and stuff, we have no influence whatsoever on the woman making the decision having the abortion because we're completely clear cut. We don't talk to them about that until they've already made the decision. But It's as you say, we've got to start with ourselves. I went to a conference for the abortion care practitioners at the Royal Society of Obstetrics and Gynecologists, and they moved all of us into the basement because they had another conference on about, I don't know, it was a childhood disease, and this was at the RCOG. So yeah, I think you need to start with us first of all.
Yeah, I just wanted to insist on the same point. I agree with all of you. And related to what Alexandre was saying, that I think being transparent is the key. And again, going back to animal research, I think a big solution was to be open in saying we do research on animals, but why and how? And again, the way that Nita has been explaining, I mean, one needs to say, not only I work with human fetal tissue, but how this is done, how it happens, how do I obtain it, what I'm doing with it. All these points are very important for people to understand. And if we are transparent about it, then no problem anymore.
So I kind of had two questions. One that's sort of been brought up a little bit is the use of language. So one side of it is obviously the use of jargon and making it accessible to the public, but also the flip side of that is, especially when it comes to human disease and brain disease in particular, a lot of that is a quite sensitive topic. And I think a lot of the time, researchers aren't quite sure how to discuss it in a manner that's both respectful and accessible. So I was just wondering kind of what are your thoughts on that?
I'll start with a general comment and I'm sure that you can say much more. I think very often it's about probably the scientists who start asking the question to your members of the public to try to better understand what he knows and where he wants to go. I don't know if I'm clear enough.
I always think that we always tend to use jargon because we are anxious ourselves in a discussion, right? Sometimes it makes you feel more comfortable to start blathering in jargon to try and get through the conversation quickly. And I think maybe just me, but I think it's really important that we realize it's a difficult conversation. Not that we feel comfortable in having a difficult conversation, but we confront that it's a difficult conversation and then it's a challenging topic. And then we also don't assume someone is an idiot, right? So it's about then trying to show there's some mutual respect in the conversation, and also at the same time taking our time to explain something. And I think time is one of the most important things. One of the things I always do if I'm having a challenging conversation, let's say in the fetal medicine unit, is I just really make it very clear to them that I'm not going to take any other calls, and I'm just going to sit there and I'm just going to talk to that family and really take the time to answer whatever questions they have, and that they can answer whatever question they have. So if I use some jargon, if I say something they don't quite understand unintentionally, that they should just interrupt me and ask. And I always find, I always find pictures and things like that useful, or to write some things out for them at the same time. And then as they're going to, because they're being overloaded with so much information, then it's useful for them to see that in front of them, and then for them to just say, can you just remind me what that word means, or can you just explain that part again?
Yeah, I mean, I never finish a conversation without telling them how they can contact me for more information. And, you know, even if I'm in clinic and I go to them, you'll see me wandering around, just stop me. And I think they need to know that there is somewhere they can go for more information.
Yeah, oh, sorry.
Second question.
Yeah, so my other one was, do you feel there's a bit of a mismatch potentially between the research questions we are asking and the research questions families and the patients are sort of more interested in? Because a lot of the time, you know, especially from like a molecular cellular side of things, we tend to get bogged down in a lot of gene details, sort of molecule details, things like that. And do you think there's, when you sort of bring that to the families and to the patients, there's a little bit of questioning to some extent, like, why does it matter? How does it actually impact the lives of the patients that we're dealing with?
Can I just quickly answer? I had a little bit extra I was going to add to your other question before that, which was just that, as Nita said, the one thing to say is that there are amazing resources out there.
Yeah.
And so I always finish any conversation with the family highlighting the resources that they can access, which include, you know, websites, leaflets, and various other organizations that they can speak to as well. Because then that means often what happens is you have a difficult discussion and then you have another half an hour thinking about it, and then you've got more things that you say afterwards. So I always highlight that there's other things that they can do, and it might be also put in a different way that's less jargony than me as well. So you know, getting it in a different way is always important. With your other question, I'm hogging the microphone. So
I think it's more for you.
So I think certainly I can answer from the perspective of clinical research. And I think from the clinical research perspective, actually, it's immensely helpful doing feedback groups and meeting with families. So I do work for two charities, a cerebral palsy charity and a charity for children with agenesis of the corpus callosum. And when we've done those kind of family days, and the family actually tells us, well, you know, it's all well and good you're telling us about this, this, and this, and connectivity emerging in the brain and these kind of things, but actually we want to know whether or not my child's going to have a language difficulty when they're older, then it kind of really highlights where we should be pushing our research and what kind of information we want to be able to give to families. And so from a clinical research perspective, yes, absolutely, it really does shape what we do. And I think it's immensely important and informative to do that. And actually, many of the funders, you won't get very far with many of the funders if you haven't done that. I think from a cellular research point of view, I'm probably less appropriate to answer that, to be honest.
I was just about to add something. I'm currently working with a patient group where the kids got a rare disease called Lowe syndrome. And actually, they're very keen to understand that. I think these family are kind of expert in the field. Mm. And they're keen to be able to participate into a scientific forum and to have a scientist spending the time to explain when some molecular biology or genetics are missing. Mm. But they're really getting expert. And I think in this type of scenario, there's really room to speak into more details.
You guys started talking exactly about the question or the point I was going to try and bring up, which is it really strikes me that you say there's 40% of scientists who are uncomfortable about talking about their work. We can see how comfortable you guys are talking about what you do. And the one thing that strikes me is that you guys have made the time and you have had the opportunity to speak with patients and with patient groups. And I think that bi-directional communication, you telling the patients what you're doing and the patients telling you how they feel about it or what's important to them, is something that a lot of us don't have. And I wonder if, you know, I mean, exactly as you pointed out, Tom, you know, funders are require us to really start building in interactions and communications, and not just in one way, in one direction, but in a bi-directional way with patient groups and individuals who are affected directly or indirectly. And I think that communication is what we all need to kind of develop, an almost like a new language to communicate with each other and to bring us out of our comfort zone into something that's more uncomfortable, but then to learn together, not as what as scientists, clinicians, patients, patient groups, but together as a whole group. And I think that's something that I think you guys are very much advocating. And I mean, at least that's what I'm getting out of it.
Yeah, there we go. Sorry, apologies. I had a sort of more general point, really, or a question, I guess. And it's about using human tissue per se in research, and whether you think the current level of legislation and regularity that we have is set correctly. I think a lot of it is a reaction to the things that have happened in the past, and actually they're probably, I work as a clinician, as a surgeon, and every day I'm throwing tissue away, I'm throwing fluid, you know, body fluids, just literally in the bin. And I would argue that that's actually unethical, or if that's the right phrase. But I just wondered if you had a comment on that, really, about how you, what you felt on that.
I think it's highly regulated what we do on the research side. There's so many loops we need to go through. A lot of time the science goes faster than the ethics. Like at the moment we're having huge discussions about the use of organoids and whether that's, we've got actual consent for that kind of thing, and about sharing stuff like that. But there's no guidelines for that at the moment. So we're having to create our own guidelines until, you know, proper guidelines come in. So yeah, it's ongoing, but there's a ton of legislation that we have to go through.
So I agree with you completely that there's so much tissue that we could be using, but I think ultimately to build that trust with the public and to build that trust across the community, actually, I think it is essential that we do have all the regulations in place. And I think in the UK, we're probably in a pretty good position, to be fair, compared to some other places around the world.
But I think because we've got so much legislation, other countries are really happy to use tissue that comes from us because they know that we've got all the guidelines and it is all ethically procured. That makes sense.
I was just wondering, to go back to the point about, you know, researchers being uncomfortable talking about their research or not knowing how to explain the benefit of particular facets of research, is that something that we're doing enough to train ourselves? Should this be something that is part of your PhD program, for example, that you should be required to be involved in public engagement, or you should be offered more training?
Can I say one thing? Do you know what? I was trying to remember his name to answer your question about the tissue thing, and I just remembered Andrew Wakefield. I couldn't remember his name, which is an awful name not to remember, but it's you know, really important, obviously, that to build that trust again, and also to avoid situations like that again, that legislature's in place.
Just to come back to this famous 40% in this study, it was about being uncomfortable speaking about their research in terms of ethical and social implication. And yes, of course, we'd love to see PhD students doing more public engagement. And actually, part of our strategy at the Gerd Institute is to embed public engagement within the research culture. We really want the scientists to feel that it's kind of a small part of their job, but it is part of their job. And actually now we reach a point where we still propose new project to the scientists, but we've got also a lot of scientists coming to propose a project and just want the support or the structure to be able to run something like that. And I guess that when you've got a group leaders willing to do such a project, it's such a good way to showcase the younger in the team that that's part of their job. They can do that, and it can really help them in their research practice.
Probably, that looks like no more questions. I'll just take that last thing, because we're probably coming to the end of our time, and there haven't been any questions online that I've missed out on. That's great. I'm going to hand over to Lee to say thank you to everybody and wrap up. But before I do that, I was just going to say that I hope I really enjoyed this, and thank you from me. But I hope that for the audience here, particularly anyone who was nervous about talking about this kind of research, we've given some of the tools here, and at least pointed you in the direction of the kind of resources that you need to be able to talk confidently about using human material for developmental biology. I think, as you said, Deepak, at the back, everyone's confident here in their ability to talk about this, and you should be confident as well. Just to echo another point, I think the working with patient groups is a fantastic way of helping you talk about the work that you do. So if I work on autism, so working with kids who have been diagnosed, I guess, with autistic spectrum disorder has been particularly valuable in helping me talk about why this research is relevant and why it's important. In terms of jargon, I think it would do us all a lot of good to remove the jargon from our talks to the public and to each other. That would be a very good idea. And finally, as a sort of party line, I always found that saying that I made green chickens really, or made chickens green, really helped. That seemed to grab people's imagination. I'm going to hand over to Lee. So thank you very much from me, but you're going to wrap up. Thank you.
Thank you so much, everyone. I feel like a round of applause is due. Yes, thank you so much. I think, sorry to get my two pens filled in answer to Rachel's question about embedding the idea of public engagement. And I think it's a real spectrum, isn't it? Because quite often I think public engagement projects are seen as big things. And the projects you presented are beautiful as well, Helen. So I really enjoyed hearing about those. But also that everyone is engaging in very small acts of public engagement all the time. So how we prepare our early career researchers and the next generation of scientists in that is really super important. And these conversations, the conversations that we had today are sort of part of that as well. So long may it continue. So really, I just want to say a huge thank you to Richard for expert chairing and helping to put together this session today, and to our panelists as well for giving up their time and sharing expertise and experience with all of us here today. So another round of applause.
And thank you to you as well for organising the whole thing. Thank you.
It's been a pleasure, and it's great to have this space in the symposium to have these conversations as well. Just as a reminder that we will, this session will be available online through our MRC website. And I think as well, it would be really useful to put on there further resources, especially links to the HDBI and HDBR for people to link through to for the work that certainly goes on in the MRC Centre as well. So on that note, I will, we can go and have a glass of wine outside. And thank you so much for all attending online and in person. Thank you. Thanks. Thank you.